beginning with the fundamental results of Lorentz integration. Now we are going to discuss the statement theorem number 2. The statement of the theorem is, if f is monotonic on closed interval AB and if alpha is continuous on closed interval AB, then f belongs to R alpha. Proof. We suppose that f is monotonically increasing because a monotonic function may be monotonic increasing or monotonic decreasing. Now we have supposed that f is monotonically increasing. What is the meaning of a monotonically increasing function? It implies that x1 less than equal to x2 implies fx1 less than equal to fx2. This is the meaning of monotonic increasing function. Let epsilon greater than 0 be given. For any positive integer n, we choose a particular partition P of closed interval AB such that delta alpha I is equal to alpha B minus alpha A by n for I equal to 1 to up to n. This is possible as alpha is continuous on closed interval AB because of the given condition. Alpha is continuous on closed interval AB. So, we can write it in this form, if the alpha is equal to alpha b minus alpha a by n, where n is a positive integer. Let capital MI, small mi, be the bounds of f in the sub interval xi minus 1, xi. This is a partition B, having the points x0, x1, x2, xi minus 1, xi, and so on to xn, which is equal to b. So this is sub interval xi minus 1. Xi. So capital MI and small MI, these are the bounds of F in this subinterval. Since F is monotonic increasing, in case of monotonic increasing function, the least epsilon will be the function value at the end point, upper end point, that is Fxi will be capital MI and Fxi minus 1 will be small MI. This will be reduced by the function values at the end points. Xi minus 1. So mi will be, capital mi will be fxi and small mi will be equal to fxi minus 1, where I varies from 1 to up to n. Now what will happen to upf alpha minus npf alpha? Now we are writing these two equations. This will be sigma capital mi minus small mi delta alpha I, because upf alpha I sigma capital MI delta alpha I small LPF alpha I sigma small MI delta alpha I. So this will be equal to sigma MI minus small MI and delta alpha I is alpha B minus alpha A by N. We are putting the value of delta alpha I. So this is finally sigma capital MI minus small MI times alpha B minus alpha A by n of upf alpha minus lpf alpha. This is free from the index I. So this is out of the sigma notation. So we are left with alpha b minus alpha a by n into sigma fxi minus 1. This is capital MI, this is small MI. And finally it will be equal to alpha b minus alpha a times. If you sum this fxi minus 1, we will be left with fxn minus fx0. But xn is b and x0 is a. So we shall get fb minus fa. We will be left with these two terms only. Rest of the terms will be cancelled out. This whole divided by n. So this can be made less than epsilon if n is taken larger. If you take n sufficiently large, we can make it smaller than a small quantity. Epsilon is a small positive number lying between 0 and 1. So this is less than epsilon if we take n sufficiently large. So finally we have upf alpha minus lpf alpha less than epsilon, and this is an essential sufficient condition for the function, bounded function f, to be RS integrable. So f belongs to R alpha on AB. Now we are going to discuss elementary properties of the Schiedler's integrals. Theorem number 3. The statement is, if f1 belongs to R alpha and f2 belongs to R alpha, these are two ordered integrable functions, R is integrable functions. On control AB, then number 1, f1 plus f2 will belong to R alpha. Number 2, integral A to B, f1 plus f2 d alpha will be equal to integral A to B, f1 d alpha plus integral A to B, f2 d alpha. Now we are going to prove these two results. First, let f is equal to f1 plus f2. We suppose that f is equal to f1 plus f2, and let E be the partition consisting of points A equal to x0, x1, x2, xn equal to b, be a partition of interval AB. Let a small mi dash is equal to greatest work on of f1x, capital mi dash is equal to least work on of f1x. For x line in the sub interval xi minus 1, xi then xi minus 1, less than equal to x, less than equal to xi. Mi double dash, small mi double dash equal to greatest upper bound of f2x, capital mi double dash equal to least upper bound of f2x, for xi minus 1 less than equal to x, less than equal to xi, and small mi equal to greatest upper bound of fx, capital mi equal to least upper bound of fx, for xi minus 1 less than equal to x, less than equal to xi. Then what will happen to fx? Fx, you can write it equal to f1 plus f2x. On operating this will give f1x plus f2x, and this will be greater than equal to mi dash plus mi small mi double dash, because these are the greatest lower bounds of f1 and f2. So in general, this will be greater than equal to this, and this will be greater than equal to this. So this plus this, that is f1x plus f2x will be greater than or equal to mi dash plus mi double dash. Now we can replace this fx by its greatest upper bound mi. So finally we get, this implies mi greater than or equal to mi dash plus mi double dash. Similarly we can show for the case of least upper bound, capital mi dash will be less than or equal to mi dash plus mi double dash. This is equal to be reverse. In case of the greatest upper bound, this will be greater than or equal to mi dash plus mi double dash. And in case of least upper bound, capital mi will be less than or equal to capital mi dash plus capital mi double dash. Now we have LP F1 alpha plus LP F2 alpha. We want to calculate the value of these two sum. That is equal to sigma. This will be sigma small mi dash delta alpha, this will be sigma small mi double dash delta alpha. So finally we have combined these two. So this is equal to sigma mi dash plus mi double dash delta alpha, and LP F alpha will be sigma mi delta alpha, because mi is the least bound, sorry, least upper bound of F in sub interval xi minus 1 xi. So what will happen to this minus this? LP F alpha minus LP F1 alpha plus LP F2 alpha. Putting these values, this is equal to sigma small mi delta alpha minus sigma mi dash plus mi double dash delta alpha. And finally this will be equal to sigma mi minus small mi dash plus mi double dash, this times delta alpha I. This is positive, greater than equal to 0, because this is greater than this. So this minus this will be positive. Delta alpha I also positive. This gives the difference of alpha xi minus alpha. Difference alpha xi minus alpha xi minus 1. That is also positive, because alpha is 1 going to increase. As mi is greater than equal to mi dash plus mi double dash, and delta alpha I is greater than equal to 0. This implies LP F alpha minus is greater than this plus this, LP F1 alpha plus LP F2 alpha. That is, this plus this is less than this. So LP F1 alpha plus LP F2 alpha is less than equal to LP F alpha. So number one. Also we have lower sum less than equal to upper sum for the function f. So LP F alpha will be less than equal to UP F alpha. So number two. And on simple putting, as we have proved this plus this less than equal to this lower sum, we can show that upper sum UP F alpha is less than equal to UP F1 alpha plus UP F2 alpha. So number three. Now combining 1, 2 and 3, we can write it in this equation. LP F1 alpha plus LP F2 alpha less than equal to LP F alpha. And LPF alpha is less than equal to UPF alpha, and UPF alpha is less than equal to UPF1 alpha plus UPF2 alpha. So number 4. Let F1 get the result here. Since F1, F2 belongs to R alpha on polynomial, it is the given condition. Right from the statement of the theorem. So there is partitions Pj, J equal to 1 and 2. It means there is partitions P1 and P2. For J equal to 1, the partition will be P1. For J equal to 2, the partition will be P2. Of course, the way is such that UPJ FJ alpha minus LPJ FJ alpha will be less than epsilon by 2. This is the necessary sufficient condition. UPF alpha minus LPF alpha less than epsilon. Here we have taken epsilon by 2 in place of epsilon. So J is equal to 1 and 2. So point number 5. Let P equal to P1 and P2 with the common requirement of P1 and P2. Now we are going to replace P1 and P2 by P. Then 4 implies from 4, this minus this will be less than equal to this minus this. So UPF alpha minus LPF alpha, this will be less than equal to UPF1 alpha plus UPF2 alpha minus LPF1 alpha plus LPF2 alpha. Now combining F1 and F2, so this, that is less than equal to UP F1 alpha minus LP F1 alpha plus UP F2 alpha minus LP F2 alpha, and this is both will be from 5. This will be less than epsilon by 2 plus epsilon by 2, that is equal to epsilon by 5.